Hello and welcome to this roundup of the 2018 Asian Games on Newsclick.in. I'm Siddhant Annie and I'm joined by Leslie Xavier and Vaibhav Raghunandan, our expert team of sports panelists.
Hi, Siddhant.
I'm sure all of you have, or many of you have been following these Asian Games intently. We've seen a fairly high level of competition, very engaging some of the events have been. So what we're going to do today is essentially talk about India's performance at the Asian Games, contextualize it with where some of these leading Indian athletes, men and women, stand in the global scenario, and examine whether their performances have actually been world class or whether we are still only at the level where we are competing on the continental level. So to start off with, let's get straight to the meat of it. The number one prospect for India, perhaps ever, as far as athletics is concerned, Neeraj Chopra.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that actually. Neeraj is the star. Neeraj is the star of these Asian Games. He is the talk of the town in a way, because looking ahead, there's a lot of prospects for this youngster, because the way he has developed in the last 2 years and the way he is looking ahead in the next 2 years where he wants to be. It's amazing. So he touched 88 meters at the Asian Games, and that distance would have earned him a bronze medal in the last Olympics. That says it.
Can I just say that, like, watching Neeraj Chopra compete in the javelin, I finally for once realized what it must feel like to be a Chinese athletics fan, because our boy was much better than the competition. And so you could just sit back, relax, watch him do his bit, and also take joy in how low everyone was compared to us. So that was like really lovely to see him do that. And like Leslie's saying, it was world class. Any of his five legitimate throws, four of them would have won gold at the Asian level. One of them would have won bronze at the Olympics. Mm-hmm. And the only men to have been bigger than this year are the two German boys who won gold and silver at the European Championships. Mm-hmm. So right now he's the third best in the world.
So Neeraj has been training under a German coach himself.
Yeah.
How much do you guys think that coach has influenced his development? That's one question. The second question is, because we don't get the chance to watch a lot of athletics day in, day out. We only get to watch athletics when there are these major events happening, right? So people expect that pichle saal isne 87 ka throw kiya hai. Iska best throw 87 meters ka hai. तो इस साल 90 होना चाहिए राइट बट ही इज अ यंग बॉय 20 साल का है अभी सो व्हाट इज द सॉर्ट ऑफ इंक्रीमेंटल ग्रेजुअल डेवलपमेंट प्रोसेस दैट ही शुड गो थ्रू सो दैट ही लाइक द चाइनीज एथलीट्स दैट यू आर मेंशनिंग पीक्स एट द राइट टाइम फॉर वर्ल्ड चैंपियनशिप्स फॉर द टोक्यो ओलंपिक गेम्स
आई थिंक इन द थ्रोइंग सीन ऑफ थिंग्स एंड वी कैन एक्चुअली लुक बैक एट व्हाट ही सेड आफ्टर विनिंग द मेडल And he's a very level-headed kid. At 20, he has that maturity to understand where what he has to do to reach there. And obviously, he's guided well by the German coach, who is the only person who has touched 100 meters as a javelin throw in history. So, the coach comes with a great pedigree, throwing pedigree, and of course, knowledge as well. So, he's been imparting that. So, what Neeraj said was that his focus in the future, in the coming months, would be to compete at the world level, Diamond League and World Championship and whatever high level competitions that come up. But at the same time, refine his technique. He was upset, imagine that, he was upset a little with the throw at the final in the Asian Games because he thought that it's going a little higher than it actually should be, the angle. So that means you could have easily gone further. Mm-hmm. So it's not about incremental distance as such. In the coming two seasons till Tokyo, I would say that it's about refining his technique in such a way that 88 would be a base distance from where he can really launch and probably touch 90 consistently, the way he is touching 85 plus right now.
So sticking to the subject of athletics, but moving on a little bit, like making it a little bit wider, there have been several good performances and like several more medals than the previous edition of the Asian Games in 2014. But is Indian athletics improving? I mean, are our standards getting higher? And if not, why?
It's actually a very tricky question because when on the general sense, we are winning medals. So it's okay. Analyzing the performances of the medals, for instance, we look at gold medal of Arpinder Singh in the triple jump. It's way below par when you look. I mean, he may not even qualify for the Olympics. Forget. So that gold medal. I mean, obviously we can celebrate. It's an achievement to be the continental champion. But will it translate to something bigger on a global stage or on a at the Olympics, for instance? It's not there. So when you look at where Indian athletics is now or where is it heading, it's not exactly a very great picture as such. It's not moved ahead by the margin that it should be to be a challenge or to be a name of reckoning on the global stage.
But this could also be true for at a certain level for Asian athletics as a whole also, in certain events, definitely. Like Tejinder Pal Singh Tur threw an Asian Games record in the shot put to win gold. But he would have not even been in the top five at the last Olympics.
Standards in Asia is not...
Not perhaps right, yeah.
Except Neeraj being the standout star in this thing. Hima Das, for instance, we are celebrating a world championship victory, a junior world championship, but our timing there was... I mean, when you look at the global standard at the senior level, it's 2 seconds off. Yeah. And at the Asian Championship as well, the Bahrainian runner, Nasser, who won gold beating her, she is world class. She is the world's best this season. Mm-hmm. And she didn't touch her best at the Asian level. Probably she felt that she is not pushed enough by the competitors. And she won by a 1 second margin, almost a 1 second margin with Hima. And so Hima, her talent, everything notwithstanding, she has a long way to go that way.
To bring that point in, because she's only been running for a very short period. I mean, and she's faster than her compatriots by a couple of seconds. The gap between her and the second fastest Indian is much more than what the gap between her and the fastest Bahrainian or whatever other runner, right? So there is definitely potential there for her to be the fastest Indian woman in both the 200 and the 400 for some time to come.
Yeah.
Would you agree?
200, I think she false started. But for the 400, definitely, she's way ahead of anyone else. I mean, if you've seen that Federation Cup video of her winning the 400, it's hilarious what the margin of victory was in the Indian scenario. I must also use this opportunity to like plug Leslie's story on Hima Das, where you were talking about how recently she started training. Mm-hmm. And while we are really, it's a great thing that in 2-3 years of training, she's gotten here. I remember reading his story and feeling like, okay, that's true, but what if we hadn't found her?
It's shameful to say that she's just gotten 3 years of development, started 3 years back, because that's not how we make champions in a country, in a setup. And Hima's case, the 200 meter false start that he mentioned, it's because she doesn't have the experience. And she said after the race that she was under pressure and she false started.
So speaking of nurturing champions, let's talk about a subject very close to Leslie's heart and mind, Bajrang. And it was for me one of the highlights of the Asian Games for sure. Tell us a little bit about, firstly, the mental aspects of a wrestling bout, how you pace yourself, how you counter whatever the opponent's thought process may or may not be, and speak specifically about his final against the Japanese wrestler whose name I have forgotten.
Takatani.
Yeah.
Now, Takatani, again, there is a history because Takatani's elder brother beat Sushil in London Olympics final. Anyways, and Sushil is important here because I think we saw probably the last of Sushil in this, in the Asian Games. Mm. And Bajrang, exciting. I feel he has announced himself as a genuine prospect for the upcoming, next Olympics. He has developed well in the last 2 years because, compared to his performance in, say, for instance, the silver medal winning performance at the last Asian Games and this gold medal winning performance. Beyond that increment of the medal, it's how he fought in the bouts, the assertive nature in which he got into it, and there was nothing reactionary about it. He knew his game plan, what is it, and he just asserted himself on all the opponents, including the Japanese wrestler in the final. Just that, the Japanese wrestler exposed one of his weaknesses, which is his opening for single leg takedowns he is prone to. Otherwise, I think he has developed his strength by quite a margin, and that helps him to dominate opponents, apply his techniques on the mat. And I think Bajrang's bout was pretty straightforward. He knew his game plan, his strengths, what is his techniques that he's going to apply. And he just went and applied it. And at the Asian level, in this year's competition, no one was there to challenge him. No one was there to force him to rethink the strategies, which is
till the final.
And finally, he showed beautifully that he is not, again, a wrestler who would bog down or who would be affected if things are not going down his way. The Japanese wrestler kept attacking his leg, scoring points, but then in the second half, he just changed it, and he changed his stance a little bit, brought it back a little, almost close to parallel, and then after that he controlled the bout in a way. But there is a weakness in Bajrang which needs to be rectified by the coaches, or else we would be throwing away, because at the world level it's a different ball game altogether. If 16 wrestlers are there at the Olympic field, 16 are equally capable of winning a medal. So it's going to be tight there, but I think he's up there for.
So speaking of coaches, kushti as a sport in India has tradition, a lot of sort of old values attached to it. It's a rural sport that's played across a large part of India, and coaches have inevitably been like gurus. And there's been a tradition of mostly Indian coaches, unlike several other sports where you bring in foreign experts, etc., etc. In the case of some of these wrestlers now, like Bajrang, for example, from his technique, you can perhaps gather that he's picked up some Iranian influences. Do you think that Indian wrestling, the fraternity at large, is more willing now to bring in aspects of other wrestling cultures rather than stick to our own traditional philosophies, methods, techniques?
After Sushil. Sushil is that 2008, the Olympic medal. After that, before that also, there were foreign coaches working with India, if I remember it right. Georgian Herlo was there, and then after that, Vladimir Machiavelli was with Sushil, the coach during Sushil's time, for a long period, in fact, 8 years almost. And Sushil benefited definitely from those foreign inputs, because the entire approach towards the bout in modern wrestling is completely different from what our traditional coaches prescribe, because our traditional coaches, they have grown up in that Akada setup where, you can't blame them either, because to perform well in a dangal makes sense economically for them, because that helps them to fund.
That helps
them to fund their training, their diet, even run their households.
Yeah.
And Bajrang's, for instance, Bajrang has been, is the second generation after, next generation after Sushil and Yogeshwar. So he has benefited definitely from Yogeshwar's influence in his bouts, because you can see certain techniques or certain ways that he moves to take down people, or the way he transitions from one technique to another. All these were Yogeshwar's hallmark. And I'm sure, and the way wrestling works, if you have a mentor, you blindly believe that mentor. And I'm sure Bajrang goes blindly to what Yogeshwar says. So in this case, I am sure Yogeshwar would have loved the new Iranian foreign coach's influence,
because if you notice, the rest of all the wrestlers, the coach who was sitting on the chair was Indian, and in Bajrang's bout, it was the Iranian, the foreign coach who was sitting there. So that tells it. That image itself tells it, and obviously it showed in the bout also. Like for instance, the ground techniques that he applied, the Irani, we call it the Irani, mm-hmm. which is the scissor lock. Mm-hmm. Sushil used to apply that, and Bajrang does that. Bajrang was going for it. He never used to earlier.
Very quickly, yeah, medal prospect for Tokyo 2020?
Vinesh and
Bajrang, yeah. Definitely.
Both, you think?
Both.
The Vinesh. Phogat sister and Bajrang.
Vinesh has shaped up well, and she would have won a medal in Rio if it was not for
yeah, it was really
injury. Yeah. Okay. So we'll move on to the next subject, and it's good for a change. I mean, there are multiple sports in which we have genuine world class talent emerging, right?
So that is definitely like a huge shift, right?
It's a shift. Mm. And of course, we can still complain about it and say that okay, there's no system in place, so there's no systematic way in which these people. There's no system that these guys come through. It just so happens that among the pool that is picked up, there are some talents that are world class. But badminton is one sport where the supply chain is thriving, right? Men, women, doubles, singles, mixed doubles. I mean, and at the Asian Games now, it's taken us a long time to win a medal at the Asian Games level. It's happened now. In good measure. What do you guys make of the, particularly the women's performance? Sindhu, Saina, of course.
I mean, now it's come to a point where I feel like there was a time, I think, in the 80s when Ivan Lendl had lost a series of finals. And I think everyone, rivals, people who didn't like him, compatriots or not, everyone just wanted him to win one. And now I feel like that's happening across the world with Sindhu. Mm. She's lost 5 in a row. She's lost 8 finals in the last 2 years. And I mean, now we just, it's great she's won a silver. It's a big thing. We've not won medals at badminton. Now we win them so regularly that we want to win gold. So that's a great aspirational shift. Mm. And yeah, I mean, it shows how much the sport has grown. The men were really a bit disappointing, underwhelming, not disappointing perhaps, underwhelming this time. But that's across the board at the Asian Games. The men who were doing well on the tour circuit have not done well at the Asian Games. So maybe there is something larger to be read there. But in the women, yeah, I mean, 2 medals, who would have thought?
Badminton development has happened in the last 10 years. Gopichand's mm-hmm. Academy, Saina coming up, then Sindhu following suit, and then the men coming up in their game. But I always felt that we don't manage our athletes really well. I mean, Asian Games victory, great. But when you look at Olympics, for instance, last Olympics, Saina's injury, I thought it's because the schedules are not being planned. If you look at, say, for instance, the Chinese battalion that come for the Olympics every 4 years, they just fade off after that a little, and then they just start building towards the games.
Fair enough. Just to play devil's advocate, I don't know if we can necessarily compare India's situation to China's situation for many reasons. Mm-hmm. One of them being perhaps that the state support that those athletes receive that allow them to come to the Olympics and then disappear and then come back or whatever, transition from one games to the other. We don't have that kind of luxury, leeway, whatever you might call it.
No, but it also becomes a bit of a problem. Like, see, also, I think now badminton has come to a level where you have to be on tour, you have to be playing through the year. It's almost like tennis. There's a full year-long calendar. You got to participate in as many events as possible. Saina's ranking, for example, was lower than what she would have normally expected it to be at the Asian Games, because of which she met Tai Su Ying in the semis. Right. If she was on the other side of the draw, if she was a little higher, then she could have gotten Yamaguchi or Okuhara, and she could have gotten through. Okuhara had skipped a lot of events in the lead up to the Asian Games. Her ranking has dropped even more. She faced Tai Su Ying in the quarters. Didn't even make a medal. Like, so, you know, this is, it's a really dicey game to play. where you have such confidence in your own ability that you don't, doesn't matter which side of the draw you're on, who you face when, you're going to be willing to get yourself a medal, or you at least get yourself to a position where it's just that match.
And losing five finals and going into a major event tournament final against the same opponent who we have never won, that gives you an historic baggage also. So I'm just, I mean, it's, see, it's, again, plugging one of my pieces. We will eventually plug one of our pieces
also.
this from the...
I think the ticker will run throughout, this, like one after the other.
This from the World Championship final when Sindhu lost. And I had actually said that we are dreaming of a Saina Sindhu final event, and why not in Tokyo? Because the quality is there, and we have two top class badminton players in the world, and they're ranked right up there, who can actually win medals for you on any stage. It's about translating that to gold now, which is a great sign, but what I feel is that we should pace their schedules. I mean, Gopichand's next job would be actually to nurture them in such a way that they are not exposed to baggages, or they are not exposed to injuries, things like that. Because managing champions is takes a different approach. So that's next 2 years would mean that, and that requires a change.
No, so the other thing that for me is really exciting about badminton as a sport is that globally, on television or in terms of drawing audiences to the stadium as well, women's badminton is the driver.
Yeah.
Unlike probably any other sport in the world.
But that's because right now the competition at the top of women's badminton is so stable, and also there's such recognizable figures.
Yeah, yeah.
When Lin Lan and Li Chong Wei were at their pomp, they were the drivers.
So, like, in just generally, in terms of when we talk about like equal pay for equal work, which we are now in 2018, and it's ridiculous that this is still an issue, but it is an issue. And badminton is putting forward the strongest case for equal pay for men and women.
Not just that, I mean,
sport at least.
I think, if I'm not mistaken, the women final at the Asian Games was held after the men's final, so that was the prime event.
Yeah,
it was the prime event.
Only world number one and world number three are playing.
Yeah, big. So that was, and although I must also say, like, this is like a nice thing that happened, which is, I mean, I'm sure when we were growing up, Indonesia was the badminton stronghold. So it was really nice to see Jonathan Christie win gold for Indonesia in badminton, and that stadium was rocking.
It was just
the only event also that has seen like a lot of, I mean, it's been unfortunate in terms of what we've seen at the stadiums in terms of spectator turnout. Not too many people have kind of come out to watch, which is really unfortunate. But badminton was...
It's a religion in Indonesia. It's actually what hockey was to India.
Moving on then. I don't know, other disciplines, anything else? One thing that stood out for me, going back to athletics for a second, and since we were talking about men and women, is the Manjeet and Jinsen Johnson in the 800 and 1500. I mean, really good, strong performances. Maybe not world class, but at least at the Asian level, it's exciting to watch these races, right? Mm.
I mean, the 800 and the 1500 are the most exciting
beautiful
track
races to watch,
because they're not just about speed, they're not just about mindless blast towards the finish line, they're not grueling lactic acid building brain numbing timed long distances. It's a race, it's strategy, tactics, years of training, mental strength, so many things come into these two races, and which is why, like, seeing Manjeet win was... He's a veteran of the sport. He has, from what I understand, he has not won much through his career. Hmm. And not many gave him a hope of winning a gold in the 800 either.
Yeah, I mean, the commentators pretty
didn't
much
even notice
ignored
him.
His existence
exactly.
till he reached the finish line.
Yeah. So it was...
That works for him, probably the... racers
going under the radar.
So probably. That worked for him beautifully, because he got into the third or fourth lane and he just boom went ahead, and even I think Jinsen was very surprised. And probably it would be interesting to see these two develop, because I think they can push each other and it will be a nice rivalry, and it can see them improve. I mean, not towards probably an Olympic gold, but Olympic medal, but
Even to see an Indian in the finals at the 400 meters in Tokyo will be a massive thing.
So
because we are not, I mean, let's face it, a nation known for
middle distance running.
Distance running.
India, the new stronghold of middle distance running in Asia.
Sounds all right.
Middle class, middle distance.
So, from all these positives, there is, I mean, although both the Kabaddi teams came back with medals, not gold for the first time, and it's a subject that we cannot ignore.
Yeah.
Another Leslie Xavier masterpiece. Detailing, it's a long piece, but I would, if anyone has an interest in Kabaddi, it's a good piece to read because it plays out a little bit like the classic Indian soap opera. It's like a family drama. There's power politics, there's court cases, there's money changing hands, there's selection drama going on. You know, there's a pro Kabaddi league, people. And there's the fact that perhaps other countries that are interested in playing this sport are catching up with where India.
But that's the thing also, like, I mean, I must say, obviously, like, it's really sad for Indian Kabaddi. But maybe it's really good for the sport also.
Like a wake-up call.
Yeah, and it's really good for the sport in the sense that Iran also claims that Kabaddi is their sport.
Yeah.
I mean, years back, I think 2 years back, when Atraj Ali, the captain of the Iran men's team, when he was in India for the Pro Kabaddi League, everyone would go up to him and he would say that he comes from the village that invented Kabaddi. And this is obviously up for debate, but who are we to deny that also? So it was really lovely to see them. As an Indian fan, it was really depressing, but when you saw the highlight, it was also lovely to see the way that they celebrated, the emotion that they had when they were celebrating the victory against India. It meant a lot to them.
For sure.
Huge.
Beating a team that has never really been beaten before.
And so, yeah, I mean, that way it's definitely good for the game. But
as far as Indian Kabaddi is concerned, there is a lot of change that needs to happen, because, and it's nothing related to Pro Kabaddi League when you say money came in and then corruption happened and all that. But this thing was happening apparently through the last 20 years or so, and things were taken for granted so much that they just ignored the possibility that
they might lose.
Yeah. And
it's like show up and take the gold and come back home.
So this Asian Games would be a landmark event for Indian Kabaddi, not because of the losses as such, but because it showed an aspect that we cannot ignore the world anymore. The game is moving ahead. And the nations are catching up, and it's not like they are better than India or they are equal to India. It's not. India still has that advantage, the base and all those things.
So, massive player pool.
But you better get things right at home. Otherwise, in some time, you won't even win a medal.
I mean, it reminds me of another great Leslie Claudius's words, when he spoke about how hockey what happened to hockey over the years, how India declined, and where he had said that they started the federation, the government, everyone started thinking that they were invincible and they could do anything. Mm-hmm. Whereas constantly the scorelines were getting tighter, the performances were getting closer, but nobody paid attention to that. And then you saw a long period of decline for hockey. So that could, I mean, they could have seen this coming at the World Cup 2 years back, when at halftime India went in the final of the World Cup, they were down to Iran. And funnily enough, the hero of that final, the guy who won us, was Ajay Thakur, the captain of this team. And he came out of nowhere, won us the game single-handedly in the second half of the World Cup final. Mm-hmm. They should have seen the warning signs there, when one man is going to win you a game.
Well, I suppose the other teams did see the warning sign and they nullified the threat that Thakur presented, right?
Absolutely.
They took care of it and and the margin of loss was not, they were not close games.
I would say that by the end of it, that there was a bit of a sheen added. Yeah. Like it was like a 1-0 in 90 minutes and then they scored on the counter attack. But sure. But yeah, I mean, it was either way, a loss is a loss is a loss.
And for those of you who haven't been following the Kabaddi scenario, what's going to happen now is going to be even more interesting because the medals at the Asian Games have already been awarded. But both the men and the women's team will come back and they'll face two other teams selected by an impartial court. The Delhi High Court has mandated this game must happen. So the teams that were selected for the Asian Games will have to come and prove that they are essentially deserving of their selection.
They are the best team that could have gone for the Asian Games. Yeah.
So keep an eye out for that. That should lead to some interesting developments in the sport.
Are they going to broadcast?
In the few
They might, the because they want years. Everyone to watch it. That'd be nice.
So, of course, I mean, a lot to talk about, a lot more to talk about. Anything you guys want to add before we wrap up?
No, but the key is that it falls directly in between two Olympic Games. So, but unfortunately, we as Indians tend to focus on peaking for the Asian Games and not the Olympics. That cycle needs to be broken. And I think there are some athletes who perceive themselves and who are world class. They have broken out of that mold. Mm-hmm. But for as a nation, for us to make a bigger impact, I mean, in relation to the population strength that we have at the Olympic Games, we need to get all the possible sports, prospective sports that way, medal prospective sports, to focus, channelize the energies, focus the athletes into something bigger and not just promotion from an Asian Games or a Commonwealth Games medal.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Whenever multi-sports events end, I feel like a huge void has opened up into my life, which I have to suddenly fill with, well, whatever your vice is.
Don't worry, we'll find plenty of sport to fill both Vaibhav's void and everyone else's. There's a lot going on. So stay tuned and join us again for our next sports chat, which will come at you very, very shortly. Thanks for watching.